Class, we'll just continue with the yesterday's class, and along with that we'll also learn some of the tasks. Okay, so what we have seen in the previous class and previous videos, we have just like we loaded the data like multiple files by using the for each loop container. So what is my scenario is that in the company, what they are going to do, basically there will be someone, there may be some third party or other people, they'll be loading the files into one location. Okay, I'll just explain you how it is going to be. Normally, I'm just giving an example for the files. So how it is going to be is that you'll be having multiple files in a folder. So there will be some source or some third party vendors. Their task is that to load the files into some path, some location. And your task is that to load the files into the tables or wherever you want by using SSIS. So this is a normal scenario. So what they do, the vendor, you will load the files daily. So what generally we do, okay, we load the files. So once we load the files, we move the files into some history folder, just for, because already we loaded the files, right? So there is no need, there is no use of the file. So we'll just move to the history folder and we make this folder empty. So next time the vendor comes, he again loads the files, and we go and we take the files and we load them. And once we load them, we'll move the files into history. So how to move the files into history? So in order to move the files into history, basically what you are going to do is that there is a task called file system task. Yeah, so this is a file system task. I'll just drag and drop it here. So when I click the file system task, normally, see, when I click, automatically you can see here, name, you can name it, is destination path variable. So whichever, wherever you want to load, you will give the destination. Okay, so that if it is a, if not a variable, right, so you will manually give them. Okay, so if it is something like variable, you will give true. See, automatically, see, it become destination variable. If I give false, it will become destination connection. Like that, you can even give the connection through variable also, and normally you can manually give them. Okay, so first we'll give manually. So destination connection, I'll manually select this. Set text connection, so not existing folder, existing folder, because I want to move to the existing folder. It is on. And one more thing, I'll not do now only, just I want to do something. See, this is a destination. Here you will be writing the name. Operation, I want to move the file. Move the file is nothing but copy and paste, right? Sorry, cut and paste. Cut and paste is nothing but move file. I'll just select move file. Okay, when I say to select move file, see, destination connection, source connection. And what I'll be doing now, I'll select the destination connection. I'll give that historical folder which I have created. So in this, whenever I load the file, after loading the file, I want to move this folder. I want to move all these files into this history folder. So for doing that, what I am going to do now, I'll just give the path for the history one. This is a folder that I'll be giving. Open, that's it. Okay. Sorry, it's a existing folder. Browse. Desktop. So this is a folder. Okay, done. You are given the folder. Okay, after that is a destination connection. And what is the source connection? I need to, once I load, I'll just click OK. I'm not giving source connection. Okay, so what is my scenario? Once I load the file, immediately I need to move only that file, not all files, right? So for that purpose, in the for each loop container, what we are doing, first it will go to the path, whatever the file path we are given, it will read the file path, and it will run for file path for 4 times. So for each file it will run one time. So for which file it is running, that file and that path will be stored in that variable, right? For each time it will be, this variable will be, value will be changed. So that is nothing but it will be my source file. Okay, just I'll drag and drop it inside the for each loop container. Now I'll just connect it to this, click on this. Now I'll give the source connection in the variable, source path in the variable true. When I click, automatically source connection becomes source variable. Now I'll go here, click on this, I'll select the variable name. So what is it? It is a for loop, yeah, for loop path, that's it. Normally what happens, see, it shows an error. What is an error here? Variable for each path is used as source, destination is empty, because that for each path, which I'll just go to the variables, you can see one variable here, for each path. Actually the for each path is empty, right? There is no value in the for each path, see, because that value you will be loading during the runtime. See, in the variable mapping, I'll just clicking cancel. In the for each loop container, in the variable mapping, you will be having that, okay? So that value will be loaded during the runtime. Yesterday we have seen, right, by using the breakpoint. So that value will be loaded in the runtime. So that's why it is empty. So during the runtime, the value will be, you will have some value there, path and that file name. But the file system task will not accept the null value. So for that purpose, just give some duplicate, just give any value. Test1.txt, something. Give anything, just only for time being, just give the value so that the for each loop container will not be empty. That's it. See. Okay, just value, because anyway, this value is going to overwrite. When you run the for each loop container, it will be overwritten, right? See. I'll just run the package now. So file system task. I just create cut and move. See. I waited here, right? So now you can see the folder also here. See. First file, you can see the first file. Second file, you got it. See, third file, you got it. Next, fourth file, see. And now, if you see that path here, when you go here, see, no file is there. After that, immediately you have loaded the file into the history one. That's it. Okay? So, this is a way you are going to use a for each loop container. Sorry, you are going to use a file system task. Not only moving the file, you can also create a directory, move a file, you can delete a file. See, when I take an option, see, when I delete a file, I don't need any destination, right? I just need source. See, you'll just getting the source, no destination is there. When I move something like rename a file, see, okay, like this, you got source and you got whatever you want. Like, you will be having many options. You can rename a file, even you can delete a directory also. Like, you can delete entire directory, you can copy a file, okay. There are many options that you can do on the files. Always, if you want to do anything, you need to pass the source. And if for some operations, you will have the destinations like copy, move and rename. But for delete directory, delete file, for that you will not have any destination, right? So there you will just get the only the source one. If I create delete directory, see, I will get only source. Okay, this is the way how you are going to use the file system task. So basically, you will be using the file system task to deal with the files whenever you want to delete a file or move a file, create a file, rename a file, that also, but you will be doing by using the file system task, okay? And next thing is that, yeah, so this is a file system task. So apart from, so we are good with the file system task. So what I am going to do, oh, so everyone is okay with the file system task? Hello? Hello. Hello, are you all okay with the file system task?
Yes.
Hello.
Okay.
Hello.
Hello, yeah. So okay, I'm just saving that. So now what I am going to do here, see here. So I'm just opening the, so we are okay with the file system task. Now, okay, I'll just in the file system task itself, I'll just open something called FTP. So let's say there may be your files may be in the remote server. When the files are on the remote server, if you want to load the files which are on the remote server, so basically I'll just have the SSIS toolbox. I can show it to you clearly now. See, when you use a file system task, I'll just drag in the file system task here, because I have disabled this too. Okay, so when you will use the file system task, just you know the file path, and there is no path, that path is not password protected. See, you'll just give a new connection, you'll connect to that path wherever the path is there, You will connect to the path, give the file name and click open. That's it. You get the file, right? Okay. Let's say if the file is located on a remote path or a remote location, then how you are going to, and that is a password protected. Okay. It may be on internet, somewhere in the web services they may locate the file and it is out of range for you. Then, and it is a password protected. How can you access that kind of file? So, for that one, there is a task called FTP task. You can get the file by using the FTP task. Say FTP means file transfer protocol task. So basically, when you have the files on remote or FTP server, then you will use the, see, you can see it here. There is like web, right? Web and server, like whenever you have the files on remote server or something, FTP server, then you will use the FTP task. So in order to connect to the FTP task from where you want to pull the data, first I'll just right click here. See, new connection. Here I'll be having one FTP connection. Click OK, FTP connection. When I add the FTP connection, the first thing it is going to say is that server name. Actually, there is a server called ftp.microsoft.com. Okay, this is a default server you will be having. It is a Microsoft server. There will be no user ID and password, so nothing to worry. See, when I did the test connection, the connection has been succeeded. Okay, this is a Microsoft server. So what I will do now, I have created FTP connection. Click on this, go to the FTP server. See, I'll just select the FTP connection manager which I have created here. You can see it, this is the thing I have created now, right? I'll just select here, then go to the file transfer. So local path is the your path, this is a remote path. So remote path, already I have given the FTP connection, right? Automatically that connection will be opened. See, oh, actually it's saying that the connection with the Microsoft server is reset. So what I can do is that I have my own FTP one. Give me a minute, I'll just check for that password. I think there is some issue with the Microsoft, I'm not sure. One minute, please. I have my own FTP, but I don't know the server name, so that's why I'm looking for that. Yeah. So actually I got one more FTP server. I don't know whether it's going to work or not. So password is, yeah, Okay, so I have my own FTP server, so just I'll be using that. So I have given the properties, now it's working fine. So FTP connection, I'll just give that connection, done. When I go to the file transfer, the remote path is nothing but the FTP. Okay, the remote path is FTP. When I click on this, see, automatically when I click on this, whatever the files I have in my remote path, I can see it here. If I click on the videos, because since I don't have the videos, it's not showing anything, okay? So, like that, whatever you will be having, you can see in the files or some web pages, you will be having the files. Yeah, actually, you are selected the send files, right? Instead of the send files, if you do the receive files, okay? Now the remote part, if you open, you can see now all the files. That is the thing. Okay, when it is a receive file, now you can see what are the pages I have created in my website with the PHP, with the text, some HTML pages I have created for my all the things. Okay, you can see all my pages are there here, all my HTML pages which are there, which I've created for the website. You can see all the text files, all the XML data, and that's it. You can see many files here, right? Let's say if I want to move one file, just I'll select this, click OK, and what I want to receive the files. To which path? I'll just give one local path. I'll create a new connection, existing folder, browse. So I'll go to the buttons, SQL class. Oh, where is that? I think it's on desktop, right? Okay, desktop, SQL class, you know, files. I'll just select this one, okay? Or else I'll select files and click OK. Okay, done. So I have set the receive files. This is my file name. Visa experience china.html. I have again clicked OK. That's it. Now when I right click this one and execute it, automatically that file will be loaded into my local system. See, it's done. If I go and see in my local system, then I can see the file. I think in the files I have given, right? See my visa. If I click on this, the web page will open, and whatever the HTML I have written for that, it will be showing that. Okay, this is the way how you are going to load the files from like different location. Like if the files are located on a remote path, then which is a password protected on, you can't, it is not on the network, then you can use the FTP task for doing that. Okay, file system task is a normal way you can load by giving the path and that one, but if you want to get the files from remote path, you need to use the FTP task. Okay, we have already seen the remote FTP. So you need to create FTP connection manager, you need to give the server name, user ID and password, and after that, that's it. So if you have some port number or anything, you will be giving. My default server port number is 21, so I have given that. Okay, this is the way you are going to work with that. So we are done with the file system task and FTP task. Okay, so everyone is clear with this?
Yeah, Bhaskar.